3 months ago, on April 18th, Silicon Valley lost a legend and a friend, Bill Campbell, who is a friend to all of us on this stage, passed away at age 75. And he was not a normal or an average person. He was integral to what goes on in our industry. And so I wanted to gather a group of people who loved him and learned from him so that we could share our stories and his lessons with you and with our live stream audience and with everyone, because he was very prickly about doing exactly what we are going to do for the next half an hour. I told him many times I wanted to write his story, and he had a few choice words for me. Jennifer Reingold, my colleague, when I told her last week we were doing this, she said, you know, Bill wouldn't have liked this. And I said, you know, if Bill told me he didn't like this, I would have said to him, fuck you, this is my call, not yours. Now, the reason I said that is that I wanted to give everyone permission to speak the way Bill would have spoken, because that's who he was. So let me introduce and welcome Shelley Archambault, the CEO of Metric Stream, John Doerr, the chairman of Kleiner Perkins, Emil Michael, the chief business officer of Uber, and Brad Smith, the CEO of Intuit. I'm going to ask each of you to quickly tell the story of when you first met Bill, what the context was. Shelley, you first.
Sure. So you have to picture this. This is 15 years ago, so I was quite a bit younger. I just got the job with LoudCloud, Opsware, Ben Horowitz and Mark Andreessen's company. I'm the only female operating exec in the company. Very male, alpha male kind of culture. Walk into the boardroom to do the overall sales, marketing, write the overall presentation. And I'm going through details about forecast, wide depth, pipeline, that kind of thing, just overviews. And one of the board members starts digging a little deep. And all of a sudden, Bill says, get the fuck out of here. And I'm thinking, whoa, what did I say? But he wasn't pointing to me at all. He was actually talking to the other board member. His whole point, and what he always reinforced, was the boardroom should be focused on strategy, on people talent, on the market, and how we're going to win. If you want to dive into details about this deal, this location, you do that offline. Do your homework first and then show up. So that was how I first met Bill Campbell.
John, the very first time. I don't know when you first met Bill.
Well, I had recruited Bill's boss, Floyd Kwame, out of Apple to be a partner at Kleiner Perkins. And I wanted to meet Bill because Deborah Radabaugh, who was the spouse of Bing Gordon, still is, was working with me to find a CEO for a bold new idea from Mitch Kapor called Go. It was a tablet computer that would recognize your writing. And so Floyd said, well, you know, Roberta, Bill, and Gene and I are going out. Why don't you come by the house? I'll introduce you to him at our home before we go out. And so I met Bill. You all know Bill, big, warm, hearty hug. He said, John, you got to come on by Claris, you know, and see what's going on, which created my opportunity.
Claris was the Apple subsidiary where he was the CEO at the time?
That's right. And they had promised him pretty much that the company could go public. There were some terms under which they'd buy it back, but they were all set to build a strong, independent maker of graphical-oriented software, mainly for Mac. And so I went on by, and I visited Bill. I liked Bill. I got to know everybody there, and Apple made the wrong decision about letting Claris go public. That created the opportunity in my lifetime, which was to recruit Bill out of Apple to go. There was a book written about that called Startup. And as Campbell likes to say, it should have been called Screw Up. And the company's name wasn't quite right either. Instead of Go, it should have been Go, Going, Gone. But that's how I met Bill.
And I will tell you that Startup is the first book. It's by Jerry Kaplan, who was the founder of the company. And
that's right.
First book I read when I moved to Silicon Valley. There are so many people who went on to interesting jobs and interesting things in Silicon Valley, including John and Bill and Mike Homer, and the list goes on and on, who are in that book.
My lesson from that is Bill had five vice presidents reporting to him. And when we had to wind that company down, he wound it down. He told us how to do that with dignity, respecting everybody in that organization. And I won't go into all the things that we did, but four of those five vice presidents, I went on to back as CEOs, and successful CEOs.
That you invested in.
Absolutely right.
Emil, share your story, please.
I was at Tell Me Networks in 1999, and John was an investor there, and he introduced us to AT&T to do this big deal with them. And I was 26 years old working on the deal, and I was summoned to present to Bill what the deal was. And went on about the deal, and he said, that's really a, it's not a sales, it's a sale. That's a real business deal, Neil. That's a nice job. And then he stood up and gave me one of his cheek-to-cheek hugs and said, don't fuck it up, and then walked out.
And think about what Emil said just now. Two interesting parts of that. The cheek-to-cheek hugs, that's no exaggeration. I mean, how many business people do we know who give cheek-to-cheek hugs to everybody that they know and like that they meet in the business meeting?
Yeah.
And then, of course, the don't fuck it up. I know, Brad, you have something similar going.
Oh, yeah. So early 2000s, Intuit had recruited me. My prior employer felt there was a conflict, a competitive conflict, and so they wanted to go to court and wrangle it out. Cost a little bit of money to do that. We came out clean. 2 weeks into the job, I'm at my first Intuit leadership conference, and behind me, someone comes up, puts their arm around my throat, cuts my oxygen off, and whispers into my ear, you're the fucker that cost us this much money. And I looked up and said, you better be worth it. And he walked off, and I turned to my person next to me. I said, who was that? And they said, that's the chairman of the board, Bill Campbell. I knew at that point what the standard was.
This is your first interaction.
That's my first interaction with the coach. That's right.
I want to, it wasn't until relatively late in Bill's life that everybody in the Valley understood that he was the Valley's coach and that he was a mentor to many people, both officially in many cases. I mean, he actually was Eric Schmidt's executive coach or CEO coach, and unofficially to people like me, he was my unofficial coach. Talk about how Bill coached, if you would, Shelley.
Absolutely, and I got lucky. I got lucky in that at LoudCloud, Bill basically adopted me. So I got to know him, obviously, in the boardroom. And I found out much later that he actually listened in to some of my sales calls that I would do nationally. He did all those things, just trying to get a sense for me, et cetera. But where he really started coaching is when I got my CEO job, which he definitely helped with. Once a quarter, I'd go over to Bill's office, and we'd lay out what's going on with the company. And he had a formula in terms of how to focus this. How do you manage your team? How do you manage the board? How are you building and focused on your overall product? Where are you getting the quality? I mean, we went through all of that. And I'd go off with kind of my list of to-dos and his suggestions and come back and report and go through. But the piece that made, in my opinion, Bill just brilliant is he could absolutely tell you are totally screwing up, right? Kick you in the pants, give you a bear hug, and send you off feeling like, okay, I just got beat up. I know I got to improve and step up, but man, he is totally behind me and supportive. And I will tell you, that is really hard to do. Really hard to do. And he really spent time to get to know you as a whole person. It wasn't just the role. It was all about the family. He knew. He asked. My husband went through some health challenges, and he sent him a personal email. I mean, it's those kinds of things. He really deeply cared. And he had a way to actually express that.
And you know what you just reminded me of? That, people have reputations as talkers or as listeners. Bill was a talker
and
a
listener. Absolutely.
John, I think it was your idea that he be Eric's coach. Did you launch his official career as an executive coach? Or was he doing it already?
I certainly introduced him to Eric. I remember that. I said to Eric, I think, you ought to get a coach, and he was quite offended at the suggestion. And then I introduced him to Bill, and he decided that it was the best business decision he ever made to take Bill on as a co-pilot, and Bill ended up coaching the whole company. I don't know if Bill was coaching before that or not. He was just naturally a coach. I think that's the way he led into
Absolutely.
It. What I want to say about his coaching style is he had a series of standard game plans, how to conduct a one-on-one meeting, how to conduct staff meeting, how to do a performance review, how to have a board meeting. But what was special about, and he wasn't right about all those things, by the way, sometimes really wrong about boards. Nonetheless, what he did not have is a standard plan for everyone. And that's what made him different. He really uniquely understood Emil, or me. And so he'd have a custom program for my development and growth as a leader. above and beyond all these like plans and game plans and even custom developments, I think he was obsessed by a set of values and a point of view about culture. And so it wasn't so much that he gave you the answer. In fact, he usually didn't. The most important thing was he understood you, he understood where you were going, and you felt safe, able to be challenged and stretched by this amazing
human word being. The word safe is such a good one. He had your back. Emil, you left Helmy a long time ago, but I assume you continued to keep up with Bill and that he continued to be a mentor to you. Would you share some of that?
Yeah, I left Helmy after we'd sold the company to Microsoft, so it was a nice ending, and that he helped engineer. And so it was on a great note that we'd worked together for 9 years and then had the success at Helmy, and then I kept in touch with him for the next 7 years, including through my Uber tenure. And, you know, he still had sage advice no matter what kind of company I was at and what the challenges were. And Uber certainly got different challenges than
Bill think of Uber?
We talked about his driver and whether we could put him on Uber or not when he had spare time. And he liked it a lot. His stepson now works on my team. He's got some of the Bill Campbell traits, which I love. And he really loves the business. I don't know. He was really enamored by it. And he thought the growth was sort of mind-blowing.
Brad, you're the only person on the stage who reported directly to Bill.
Yeah.
Talk about that, if you would.
Yeah, well, after that initial bear hug, he started meeting with me every 2 weeks. So I was general manager of three of our businesses. And even though I wasn't reporting in to him or the board, he would still schedule one-on-ones with me. And everything you talked about was always present every one-on-one. The first thing about Bill was he gave you a bear hug. The second thing, you wanted to know how your girls were doing or your boys were doing and your family, and ask specifically about your spouse. And then he would have 3 to 5 things he had already prepared in advance he was going to go through. So he had a playbook. And then, of course, the last 9 years as CEO, he was our chairman of the board. So we met every 2 weeks. I think the story that really resonates for me when I think about his coaching is he had a philosophy. He said, your title makes you a manager. Your people will decide if you're a leader. And he did not believe in positional authority. He believed that the job of a leader was to ask the right questions that inspired the imagination so people would dream big, and then to create the environment where they could do the best work of their lives. And that's where John was touching on. It's all about culture, all about values and people. Now, he had playbooks, but he left me with one thing, is your title makes you a manager, your people will decide if you're a leader. And now it's up to you to live up to that.
Would you share with everybody what it's like to be dressed down and chewed out by this wonderful, loving man?
It's very much the way Shelley described it. So we had a very tough time coming through the recession, and we felt that we had gotten a little out of shape, and we had to restructure certain parts of the company, and some of the teams were ready to make the announcements on a certain date. Other teams wanted to make their announcements 6 weeks later. I sat with Bill. I said, you've had experience. In fact, the last time our company did this was when you were the CEO. How do I handle this? He said, one and done. You do it on a Thursday, never on a Friday. Don't let anybody have to think about it over the weekend. You want to give them time to talk, but make sure you get it done and let people get focused on tomorrow. Well, I succumbed to the pressures of my staff, and some said, well, we're not all going to be ready at the same time. We can't delay, and they can't move faster, so we did a two-step, and we paid the price. The employees walked around for a while talking about it. There was a lot of commiserating. Bill sat down with me and said, that was the biggest mistake you've ever made. The good news is we will never make that mistake again. And I haven't. I've made plenty more, but not that one. But it came with a few more colorful terms along the way. But
you're the CEO of a public company. You're not going to follow me down that road. Is that what you're saying?
Hey, I've already dropped my one F-bomb.
Oh,
I got plenty more in that one.
I forgot that you did, Brad. If I remember my history correctly, Helmy had a lot of tough times. And was Bill on the board?
Bill was unofficially on the board.
Because Bill was extremely fond of Mark Andreessen and Ben Horowitz, and Mike McHugh, who's CEO of Helmy. I'm sorry, I'm getting mixed up. Helmy. Talk about Bill in the bad times.
So Bill had two things that I remember from the Helmy days when things would get hard, which is what I learned early on as a leader, which was he would lean into hard problems. He said, don't shy away from them. Most bad leaders go away from them and solve the easy ones. And he said, go right in there, do something before you think you really want to do it, whether you have to let someone go or whatever, just be brave about it. And that helped through the Helmy hard times. The other thing is you know, he said that great companies were bought, not sold. So when you get in hard times, it's tempting to say, like, maybe we should sell this thing. And he said, that's terrible thinking in hard times. The thing we should do is, like, get back to building a great company, and if someone wants it and you truly make it great, someone will want it. And those two things proved out to be very true. And tell me, we sold it for, a handsome profit for the investors and for employees.
I want to share something about Bill that occurred to me over the years. So Bill was a football player in his youth, and then he was a football coach, and he was the absolute epitome of a man's man. You know, he liked to drink beer, he liked to hang out with the boys, he wanted to talk sports, he wanted to play sports, but he didn't have just one type. He liked all kinds of people, and you didn't have to be like Bill for Bill to love you. You shared a story with me about some ideas that Bill had that you can see where I'm leading, Shelley.
Yeah, absolutely. So Bill was very focused on diversity, especially gender diversity, frankly, before it was cool or even in the news. When we got started and got to know each other, one of the things that I had done when I became CEO, since I didn't have any peers, was to actually create some peers. So I pulled together a group of women that were also building companies, and we would get together periodically to share ideas, use each other, et cetera, and I invited people in to come talk to us periodically, and I invited Bill to come talk to us. Well, that come talk to us once turned into our group meeting with Bill every quarter for 8.5 years, and it was fabulous. Bill and I talked about the challenges that women were having in Silicon Valley, and it was frankly his spark. He said, we ought to do something focused specifically on the female entrepreneurs. And I said, you're absolutely right. And together we created and launched a Women's Entrepreneurs Conference that we do in Silicon Valley once a year, for women, by women. And the focus is women are the speakers. So you have women VCs, women CEOs, women talking to women that are trying to build businesses and get it done. And that is something that he funded. I did all the work, working with a group called Watermark. Gordy Davidson from Fabric and West provided the space, and we started this thing, and it sells out every single year because we're very focused, and we really help people get kind of those steps, et cetera. But Bill, one of my favorite sayings from Bill, when he'd look at a group or a management team, et cetera, and he'd say, we need to change, right, the overall profile. And what he would say is, yes, we absolutely need to and will hire the best person for the job. And the best person for the job can be a woman. It may just take a little longer. But he was very, very focused on making sure that the pipeline and all of that was reflected in how people made decisions. And I'm sure with the companies, Intuit, if you look at Intuit's profile, their board, if you look at the team, et cetera, you'll see it. But he was very focused on that. I think that's a key legacy of his.
Absolutely.
Shelley reminded me of something, relatively trivial when she said that he funded this group. Bill was very generous, and there were wonderful stories at his memorial service and funny stories about the things that he paid for. And that, you'd never bought Bill a drink. I threw my journalistic integrity to the wind a long time ago because with him over beers, because I never paid for one. Mm-hmm. He enjoyed spending his money, I think, that he had made, because he didn't have a lot of expensive habits. He had a few, right, obviously. Yep.
And you had to force him to accept compensation.
Oh.
It was a battle to get him to take equity in Google. He wanted to give back. Mm-hmm. He wanted to contribute. He really believed he was the luckiest hard-scrabble kid from Homestead, Pennsylvania, who left a losing football record. People always asked, well, why did you go into coaching? He said, you ever look at my football record? This is like 5-4. Then he went to an ad agency. He was working at Kodak. He left an $18 billion Kodak company to go to work at a $90 million Apple company. And it all worked out. It really worked out.
John, Bill loved business, but he didn't necessarily feel that he had to follow everybody else's rules on business. And so, Bill managed conflicts in a different way than other people managed conflicts. And I'd like you to talk about, if you would, the unusual role that he played at Google and Apple and other places, I assume. But that was the most interesting one.
Well, And there's so many people out here who know Bill. I know Bill was on Jim Barksdale's board at Netscape. So if you open this up at all, I want to hear Jim's views about him. But Bill, at the same time, was, I think, the longest serving board member of Apple, 17 years. And he attended every Google executive staff meeting on Mondays sitting in the executive staff meetings. And these companies were initially deep partners and then deep rivals. And it drove Steve crazy. He said, choose. And Bill said, if you make me choose, you're not going to like the choice. And besides, I can't even spell HTML. I don't know how to write code. So I'm just helping them be a better company, helping them be a better company. And to this day, no one has ever questioned his integrity.
Mm-hmm. Jim, would you nod your head if you want to add something at some point? I'll get you a microphone if you don't shake your head, and that's fine. You just blinked. All right, well, let's get Jim a microphone, please, in a second. Brad, can you add to that? You had a different perch from Intuit about how Bill juggled all these many business activities that he had.
Well, first of all, no one questioned his integrity. I mean, when you confided in Bill, it stayed with Bill. Bill wouldn't do interviews. He wouldn't talk to anybody else. He didn't want anybody to know when he had given someone a gift. And so that was what you knew you were dealing with. So you had this person of integrity. And then everyone basically knew that even though he may be working with someone that you compete with in the marketplace, your secrets were safe with you, their secrets were safe with them, and he would never divulge those secrets. Now, he had that same point of view about employees and employees who left the company. And there was a period of time, Bill actually evolved, where if you left the company, in some cases, you were dead to Bill.
We're out.
And then it got to the point where Bill said, you know what, I'm going to step back and realize, because many of those employees would choose to come back, in which case he celebrated them as alumni and said, I want you to tell your story. Why did you come back? What was the mistake you made, and why are you home again? And so he used it as an opportunity to get other people to understand the grass isn't always greener. But what I always found that helped him navigate that, and it was the story that John just shared, is Steve knew deep down, you know, that Bill wasn't divulging any secrets at Google about what was happening at Apple. Bill would play it off by saying, look, I don't even know how to do that stuff. I'm just over there talking about leadership, and everyone knew that was true.
And it is interesting. You know, do you have a technical background, Shelley?
No.
No, so John's the only one here, I think, with a technical background, and that includes me. Bill was the ultimate non-technical Silicon Valley person,
yeah.
And I think he reveled it. Jim, thank you for allowing me to put you on the spot. Would you like to share anything?
Well, they just handed me a microphone, so I guess I got to do something. Now, Bill was a great guy, great friend, and a great mentor to me. When we were starting Netscape, John introduced me to Bill. I assume that's how I met Bill. I love Bill. He later on, after we had been going 3 or 4 years, we needed another board member. I forget why. And so I was quick to ask Bill to join our board. He joined the board, and then the next time I saw him, he says, boy, Steve threw a fit, because he was on the Apple board at that time. I said, why? He said, damned if I know. He's just jealous. He wants to keep me and not let you share me. I said, well, tell him we're happy to have you. He said, no, I just told him to get fucked. But, you know, one little side, like Bill and Homer had their life's mission to visit every baseball stadium in America. I don't know if you all remember.
Oh, yeah. Now, this was Mike Homer, who was your head of marketing at Netscape,
right.
A dear friend of Bill's.
Apple and good, great friend of Bill's, personal friend. And I think it tells sort of the story that once you were Bill's friend, unless you abandoned him, you were a friend for life. He was just that kind of guy. He didn't play different levels of friends or positions, things like that. He was just a wonderful man.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing that, Jim.
Can I add a
Please?
Point? One of the things that I think Bill did for a lot of CEOs, and especially the first-time CEOs that he started coaching, so like myself, is you come into a role, and things are new. You know a lot, but frankly, until you're actually in that seat, there's still a lot of things that you have just not experienced. And Bill was really good about helping to, frankly, shore up the courage. Right? It's a little bit more than confidence. To be a really good CEO, you have to have a lot of courage, because you make a lot of decisions with not enough or as much information as you want. And it's all about the courage, right, to take that step or make that call. And he was good about being able to do that without telling you what to do. I mean, it was rare that he actually told you what to do.
Yep.
He asked you the questions, he made you think about it, right, he did all those things. But the courage piece was really important. I remember I was hired by Vinod Khosla. Vinod Khosla is a very strong personality. Kleiner Perkins, right, was the company. He was with Kleiner at the time.
He'd
and
laugh at you for calling Vinod a strong personality. Go on,
I don't know how to describe that.
Cut the crap.
You're right, okay.
What do you really think?
But this is being taped. One of the big challenges is you were good with Vinod as long as you agreed with Vinod. Right? If you didn't agree with Vinod, then there was a problem, and there was a challenge. And we had a point where, frankly, Vinod really felt should go here, and I was going here. It wasn't even close. It was here and here. And I had the conversation with Bill, and I said, here's what I'm going to do. And frankly, having the courage from him, I came home, told my husband, listen, tomorrow I may no longer have a job because I'm going to go tell Vinod that I'm doing this and he wants me to do this. But having someone like Bill, frankly, that you can talk through, get it, really helped with that courage point to be able to go and take those steps. And the good news is I ended up being the longest serving CEO under Vinod. He tended to churn through CEOs because I held my ground.
Please, Brett.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I wanted to pick up on this because courage has now come up from everybody. Bill loved people that basically, he said, had dirt under their fingernails, get shit done kind of people. He did not care what school you went to. He did not care whether or not someone thought they had the highest IQ or not. He cared about people who got stuff done. And that validated a lot of people. He came from a small town, Homestead, PA. He cared about that sort of hard scrabble upbringing, and he made other people feel like they were capable of doing stuff. He and I were sitting around one day, and we were talking about a speech I'd heard, and I could tell this was towards the last few months, and we were over at his house and on the couch, talking about the Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom and those wildebeests that run up to the river, and there's crocodiles in the river, and they got to make it across, and you see they're kind of stampering, and eventually one jumps, and then they all jump, and they try to get over, and one or two get taken out, but 98% of them get across. And Bill looked at me and said, God made a very special wildebeest when he made that first wildebeest. And those are the kinds of people that Bill loved. The courage to lean into the things that were uncertain, be okay with failure, be okay with success, but just give it a shot and lead people to the next opportunity. And that's the kind of stuff Bill was made of.
John, do you have any, as I said when we started, Bill was very prickly about, he didn't like talking to the press. He made it clear to me many times that he didn't like reporters and he didn't view me as as one when we were drinking. But why, he genuinely did not care about getting attention and he didn't want to tell his story. Do you have any sense why?
He worked with a lot of star celebrity CEOs.
Yes.
But I don't think he liked ego. He believed in team, and,
yeah,
and he lived the kinds of values that he shared. I don't think you can be an effective coach and be on stage. You got to be off stage, maybe calling the plays, maybe whispering from the side. And so it's his values, who he is, yeah, how he did his work. He didn't want to be compensated. He didn't want to get the credit. He wanted the relationships. He wanted to make a difference. He wanted to contribute. He wanted to give back.
Yeah, I think the give back piece is key. And I think one of the other pieces was, frankly, he didn't want to take anyone's shine away. You know, so part of being a coach and helping, as John said, you have all the stars. But if it was suddenly, this is a Bill Campbell CEO, it's a Bill Campbell, well, that might actually diminish. And I don't think he ever wanted in any way to diminish what
right.
people have accomplished.
And he verbalized that to me.
Mm-hmm.
He
yeah.
said, if I'm telling the story.
Right.
Quickly, Brad.
I was just going to say, and he gave without any expectation or desire to get. And the most recent example was a group that he used to get together with that were with him at Apple and at Next and other places. And Caroline Donahue's in the audience. They got together after his passing, like they always did at the Old Pro, the sports bar that he was a part owner of. And they were telling stories and reminiscing. At the very end, they were ready to pay the tab, and they came up and said, no, the tab's been covered by Bill, and it'll continue to be covered by Bill.
Oh, wow.
And so yeah. he's still giving.
Unbelievable. So I didn't want this to be maudlin, but Bill was very fond of his communities, and he had many of them. Columbia was one of his communities. I didn't know until his memorial service that he was very involved in his church, the Catholic Church, but he was, and that's because we never talked about religion. We talked about many, many, many things and never that. And he also cared about Silicon Valley. And so the reason I wanted to do this is that we care very much about our community at Fortune Brainstorm Tech, and it's a very fitting way for us to end our conference and for me to thank the four of you. Thank you for
thank
being
you.
Here.
Thank you.